नमः पार्वती पतये। गोविंदनाम संकीर्तनम्।
नृसिंहोपुङ्गवचेतनते सदामयतान्महि गोपीसुधीः शरणागतवत्सल तत्सलिले भवशङ्कर देशिकमी शरणम्।
जय जय शंकर हर हर शंकर।
Namaste children, namaste parents. I'm once again glad to see you all here. We are all assembled here to hear the Adi Shankara's story, and we have been seeing stories of Adi Shankara, his childhood, and how he became a sannyasi, and about all his shishyas, disciples. There are so many disciples for Adi Shankara, but the prime disciples of Adi Shankara, there are four prime disciples of Adi Shankara. Can anyone name them?
There's Sureshwaracharya. Kumarila Bhatta, I think.
Acharya. And? Padmapadar and Hastamalakar, those four are the prime disciples of Adi Shankaracharya. So last session we have seen about Totakacharya, how the Giri became Totakacharya. We have seen Hastamalakar, we have seen how Sanandanar became Padmapadar, and how Mandana Mishra became Sureshwaracharya. So all those disciples we have seen. So before going into the story, we will start with an invocation. We'll start with the prayer, okay? Om Shuklam Bardaram Vishnum Shashivarnam Chadurbhujam Prasannavadanam Dhyayet Sarva Vigno Vashantaye Guru Brahma Guru
Vishnu Guru Devo Maheshwaraha
Guru Sarshad Parabrahma Tasmai Sri Guruve Namaha Guruve Sarva Lokanam Shikharokinam Nidhiye Sarva Vityanam Dakshinam Putinam Tennadudaya Periyava Potri Ennattavarkum Niraiva Potri Sarvajna Sarva Vyabi Periyava Charanam Maya Piraparukkum Maha Periyava Adi Potri. So we will start with the story. Now Adi Shankaracharya is now in Sringeri. So he is, residing in Sringeri. Now Todakacharya has come there and everybody was there in Sringeri. But now, once again, what happened? One day, he could not take the class. That is, he was delaying the class. He was delaying the class. But now, it was due to some other reason. Last time it was due to Todakacharya, no? He was coming and he was delaying the class. Now it is due to some other reason. Because, his mother, that is Adi Shankaracharya's mother, who was in Kerala, Kaladi, she was ill. She was in her deathbed. She was completely ill. She was all thinking of Shankara. She was, when Shankara, went to take sannyasam, before that, Shankara gave a Gopalan's murti. Gopalan means Vishnu's murti to his mom. And he said that hereafter he will be your son. You look this Gopalan as your son. But this Aryambal couldn't see Gopalan as a son, because she was always thinking of Shankara only. She was always chanting Shankara's name. And she was also hearing, how Shankara became famous, and everybody was speaking about Shankaracharya, isn't it? Adi Shankara and all. But now she is in deathbed, and now, and intuitively, this Adi Shankara, who was sitting in Sringeri, through his intuition, through his, divine eye, he could see that his mother, was in deathbed and he has to go there. So what happened is, he flew with his yogic power. He flew there to Kaladi, from Sringeri to Kaladi, and he was there in front of her, his mom, and his mom was you know, closing her eyes, and she was chanting Shankara's name. Oh Shankara, where are you? See, where are you? Where are you? She was chanting. She was just blabbering, like, you know, her mouth. He was chanting his name always. She was chanting, and Shankara said, "I am here, mom. I am here in front of you. See, I am here." Her tears were, you know, covering her eyes. Her tears were covering her eyes, and she was wiping her tears, you know, and she saw Shankara was sitting in front of her. She was all very happy, you know, at the moment, you know, she was so sick and all. Of course, she was sick, and, you know, all the relatives were there and all. But, you know, all the relatives, you know, they were all standing there just waiting for her death. They are all, you know, only standing there for her wealth, not for her. Tears were rolling, and, you know, even Adi Shankaracharya was touched. You know, even in his eyes, tears were rolling, because, you know, it was his mom who was in the deathbed, and who was sick, and she was suffering from pain and all. So what happened is, she looked very pale, weak, in the bed. And even though the Acharya, you know, this Adi Shankaracharya, he was a great Acharya, and who was a scholar, and you know, who was very Advaitic exponent and all, even he felt very bad. He felt very sad inside his heart, seeing his mother like that, you know. But Aryambal, you know, she opened her eyes, and she was just, you know, touching Shankara's, the whole body of Shankara, and she was saying, "Oh my God, my son, you have all grown up. See, I have seen you as a little boy. You were only 8 years old when you left. You know, now you are all grown up, and you have all the shaven head and all. You have become a sannyasi, you know, but you look the same. You know, I love you, and you look the same here. You know, you are all grown up. That's it. You are all grown up. I know." You know, Adi Shankara was, you know, feeling very sad, and tears were rolling, and from his eyes. And, you know, he who was a great saint, and, you know, who had all the knowledge, and he was considered to as a, you know, Parameshwara himself, you know, avataram of Parameshwara himself, and to whom all the, you know, different schools of thoughts, different schools of philosophy, you know, had bowed down, you know, he debated with all the scholars, and he won, and he was recognized as a great teacher of Advaita, as a great personality. That great saint, that great Adi Shankara, you know, a scholar, prostrated before his mother, you know, before his mother. And then when she saw him, she was immediately, you know, she became free from all her distress. Of course, she was in, you know, she was not comfortable. She was in pain. She was suffering, you know. But on seeing his son, you know, after all the years, you know, was such a joy for her. And, you know, when someone who was suffering from, you know, scorching heat, and without any shelter and no shade, and when you see the rainy clouds, you know, rainy cloud is coming, he will feel so much relieved, isn't it? He will feel so much relieved. It is said that she felt like that. Adi Shankara's mother, Aryambal, she felt like that when she saw him. He was in front of him, no? And Adi Shankara, you know, even though he was fully established in non-attachment came to his mother, and his heart melted seeing his mother like that, in that you know, position, in that stage. Okay, he told his mother, "Don't be sad, mom, don't be sad. I am by your side. I'm always by your side." Okay, his mother, you know, saw Adi Shankara and told, you have changed a little, because you are grown up. You're all now grown up. You are a little boy, but now we have all grown up with a shaven head and all. But still, I could see the face, you know, this face. All the time I am seeing this face. All the time. Adi Shankara's heart melted like anything. He chanted on that moment. He chanted Matruka, Matruka Pancharatnam. See, that's a very good, very, very beautiful song. Beautiful slogan. Matruka Pancharatnam is a very beautiful slogan. This is, you know, he chanted that in front of him. This is a very, very beautiful stotram. And when Adi Shankara, where Adi Shankara has described a mother, you know, right from the formation of a child, you know, in the womb, right from the formation of child in the womb, how the mother, you know, right, mother carries her baby, you know, mother carries her baby, you know, till her end. He carries his her child in her womb only for 10 months. But, you know, for the rest of the years, he carries her child always in the heart. You know, always in her heart. That is why mother is always considered as a number one god. Mother is always considered. You see, everyone should, you know, everyone should give respect to your mother, to parents. You know, because parents are our obvious gods. Isn't it? Parents are our, we have not seen God. Nobody has seen God. But we have seen our parents. See, we can see God in the form of parents, you know, in the form of mother. Always, you know, always, they always think of us. They always think of us. They are all selfless. They always think of us. They are selfless. So now Adi Shankara asked his mother, if you want something, if you want something, and if you just tell me, you just tell me if you want something, I will do it. I'll do it for you. Okay. If you wish for something, if you wish, then I will do it for you. Okay. So this is our final moment, isn't it? In our final moments, anything you want from me, anything I could do, okay, I can do it. So she was so happy to see her son. Since it's a perfect mother, isn't it? So what the mother wish, you know, the mother, so she was very happy to see her son in good health. First of all, he is in good health. So she said, she was very grateful. She was very grateful to see him and, you know, seeing him like this, and said, what else can I wish for? You know, my son is doing a very, such wonderful thing, wonderful work. You know, there is a Tamil saying called Sandron ena ketta thai. Means, that's a very famous Tamil saying like that. You know, is that every mother would wish for that only. Isn't it? So you are happy, you are healthy, you are doing so good for the world, the whole world, you are doing so good. And then she told him, my son, you have so many divine powers, but my time has come. You know, I have to go. I don't want to live in this body anymore, any longer. The only thing I ask for you is, in this final moment, you just bestow on me the highest knowledge. That is, guide me so that I can realize the self. You know, I can realize myself, the, you know, with all myself, and I will get liberated from this body. I'll become free. So now what happened? Adi Shankara is out of all compassion, all love, you know, Adi Shankara began to instruct the nature of a Brahman, like a nature of Brahman, the highest consciousness, explaining to her in all the, you know, beautiful nature of this knowledge, so that, you know, that is, you know, it's eternal, it's all pervading, and it's all unattached, it's all very pure, and it's all ever whole, and it is all present in all diversity. So he was explaining this kind of bliss, you know, that is universal bliss. But and all, he was explaining all these things, Advaitic principles and philosophies and everything. He was all explaining. But then he looked at his mother, you know, but the mother looked at him very sad. He looked at him very, very sad. He said, dear son, you are sharing the highest knowledge. That's a beautiful philosophy and knowledge. But you know, I'm very simple. My mind is very simple. My mind is very simple. So I'm not able to comprehend. I'm not able to comprehend something which is so abstract, so impersonal, so something which is, you know, something which is everywhere, all pervading. I'm not able to relate to that. So she was very modest. She was very modest and humble. And she said, my intellect cannot understand. You know, you are so advanced for me. But for me, there are just, these are all only concepts. These are only concepts, you know. So it's not translating into any experience, into an experience. So, and I cannot relate to it. So I'll be, you know, I will not be able to find any peace this way. First of all, she asked about the highest knowledge, but now she realized that, you know, she could not get any peace this way. So my soul will not be, you know, able to evolve this way. So, and then she asked, instead of you, you know, explaining all the philosophies and Advaitic knowledge and all, which I couldn't relate, you can sing the praise of Lord, you know, the praise of God or the divine, praise of the divine. So allow me to have a vision of the Lord, vision of God, you know, allow me to have a vision of God. So that, you know, I can merge in that. I can, you know, he felt so much, you know, Adi Shankara felt so much love for her, for his mother. And he felt very pity. First, initially, he felt very pity because he wanted to give her the highest knowledge, but it is not possible for her to grasp it, grasp that kind of heavy knowledge. So he decided to chant a beautiful hymn in praise of Lord Shiva. So by doing this, he chanted all the slokams of Shiva. And by doing this, what happens? He summons the emissaries or the attendants, or you can say assistants of Lord Shiva. That is Bhuta Ganangal. We say Shiva's assistants are called Bhuta Ganangal, isn't it? So he invoked that. He invoked them and they started appearing. See, they appeared there. But since they were all Shiva's assistants, they are all Bhuta Ganangal, isn't it? They look very scary. They have, you know, all their tridents and they were covered with ashes. They were covered with ashes and, you know, with garlanding with bones and everything. You know, by seeing them, you know, Adi Shankara's mother became scared. Oh my God, what is this? Somebody is coming. Oh my God, I couldn't see that. So she got frightened, you know. She was not comfortable. Because, you know, it was looking very scary for her. It was looking very, very scary for her. So, seeing her scary face, now, Adi Shankara immediately, you know, recited a hymn on Narayana, Vishnu. In the Milky Ocean, you know, Vishnu is said to be a very beautiful person. You know, beautiful, beautiful look, you know. Beautiful looking God. Narayana is said to be a beautiful looking God with all the ornaments and all the garlands and crown. And he was sleeping in that milky ocean. And it was all very pleasant, you know, beautiful. And Narayana is always described as a very beautiful, beautifully. But sometimes Shiva is also very beautiful only. Shiva is also called Sundara. Sundara means beautiful. But sometimes what happens, Shiva is described as very fierce God, isn't it? That's why she got frightened. And, you know, so what happened? He invoked the assistance of Narayana. Now, Narayana's assistants will be like Narayana only. They were also very looking very beautiful and all. So they arrived with the divine vehicle, that is a Pushpaha Vimana. It said that Pushpaha Vimana, isn't it? So they all arrived with that divine vehicle. And seeing them, seeing Narayana and his disciples, and I mean his assistants, Nimishree, she felt very happy. You know, the mother was, Ariambal was very so happy. She was so comfortable. She was so comfortable. She thanked her son. See, you have such a divine power that I could able to get the vision of Narayana himself and, you know, all the Devadutas. You know, she expressed her gratitude, you know, her gift in her final moments. And it is said that, you know, hearing and looking, she was hearing the beautiful hymn of Narayana from Adi Shankara himself, you know, and hearing and looking at the beautiful, you know, descriptions of Narayana in her mind's eye. You know, she was looking at her mind's eye. She just ascended the vehicle. She ascended the vehicle with a subtle body, you know. She went to those, all the lokams, she traveled, and finally she went to the Vaikundam, the abode of Narayana. She could reach the Vaikundam, you know, along with the Vishnu Thudal, you know, Vishnu disciples or the assistants of Vishnu. She could reach the Vaikundam, the abode of Vishnu at last. With the help of Adi Shankara, she can reach there. Now, Adi Shankara, what happened is Adi Shankara felt very sad for a moment, you know, she left her body and all. But he decided that he will do the final rites, final cremation of the body, you know. He has to do. He decided that, like that. You know, he planned to do the final rites, you know, cremating the mother, his mother's body himself. Which is very uncommon, which is not common. Because, you know, traditionally, normally, you know, when one who has taken sannyasam is excused, they are all exonerated from all the responsibilities and duties, isn't it? So, but then he was the only son. He was the only son of Ariambal, and above that, you know, of his mother, all that, at that moment, he wanted to remain only as her son. He wanted to do that. But all the relatives, it is said, you know, it is her wish also. Ariambal's wish also to do that. So he was a sannyasi. He wanted to do it all by himself. But the relatives, you know, they argued with him. The relatives, they never allowed him. And they all argued with him. He never, you know, cared. Adi Shankara never cared. He wanted to do all the arrangements. He wanted to, you know, he wanted to call all the relatives and the neighbors, you know, who are there to help him to do with the final rites, you know, final ceremonies of his mother. But they were all unwilling. They said that, you know, they said they were disgusted. No, we couldn't do with him. And they laughed at him. And they questioned, see, why are you as a sannyasi, you know, as a renunciate, even consider doing this? You are not eligible. You are not an eligible person to do this final rites, you know. So how are you competent? How are you competent to perform the final rites? You are not competent, okay? So it's not your place now. It's not your place. Because it requires Agni. It requires fire to do the cremation, isn't it? But as sannyasi, that fire will always be with the householder only. So the householder maintains the fire. And that fire is used for cremation. But here, he is not a householder. He became sannyasi. So he is not allowed to touch the fire. Isn't it? So how can you cremate the body? It's not, you know, it's traditionally, it's not good. It's a, you should not do that. But, you know, they were all scolding. They were all scolding him. But, you know, so seeing the, you know, insensitivity, he became very angry. Adi Shankara became very angry. He himself, you know, what happened is at one point of time, he just lifted the body. And what happened is he lifted himself all by himself and kept the body in the backyard of his house and started, you know, nobody has given fire to him. So what happened is he chanted Agni Deva's mantra. So Agni Deva, you know, Agni Bhagavan is the fire god, isn't it? So what happened is Agni himself, what happened, he knows that this body, you know, this is Parameshwara's mother. this is Parameshwara's mother. So he obligingly, you know, swallowed the body. That is, he cremated. He cremated the body. So the mother and the child bondage, you know, nobody can argue with that. That is the bondage. Wherever it is like that, you know, nobody can question the bondage between mother and son. So that's why, you know, Adi Shankara, you know, he broke the rule. He broke the rule and he cremated. And it is also said in one of the Adi Shankara, Shankara Vijayam, it said that, you know, like, you know, he cursed those people at Kerala, you know, they cursed, he cursed, you know, he said that, you know, those one set of people is there, they used to cremate their body on the backyard only. They were allowed to cremate their body in the backyard only. That's how he cursed. There's something, some stories like that. What happened is he cremated everything and everything is done between Adi Shankara and his mother. Now Adi Shankara, you know, he was returning to Sringeri after doing all these rites. He was returning to Sringeri. He flew back. He flew back to Sringeri while he was, you know, after doing that final rites. Okay, he, by means of his yogic power, he flew to Sringeri. But what happened is on the way, traveling back from Kaladi to Sringeri, he was somewhere magnetically attracted. Somewhere magnetically attracted in some place. So he bent, he saw, which is that? Why am I attracting? I'm getting attracted. What is this place? So he saw that it's a Guruvayur Kshetram. Guruvayur Kshetram. Guruvayurappan is there. Guruvayurappan is, again, what? Who is? He is a Narayana himself. He is Vishnu himself. Guruvayurappan is a Vishnu himself, isn't it? It's a small Vishnu. So it's a Krishna. Lord Krishna, Lord Krishna, you know, if you know Krishna's story, then Krishna is a god, you know, who always attracts everybody. Akarshanam means he attracts everybody. He's very beautiful. He's a child and he's a very beautiful child. So he saw that, you know, Guruvayur is there and he's a Mayavi. Mayavi means what? Everybody is getting, you will get attracted towards Krishna. So he's a Mayavi in the right sense. Though he is an Advaitic sannyasi, he was attracted and he traveled to, you know, Guruvayur Kshetram. Then Guruvayur, he performed puja and all to Guruvayurappan, and then he went again to Sringeri. And then in Sringeri, he established Sharada Pidam. He established the Sharada Pidam there and appointed Prithvi Davar, one called Prithvi Davar, as the head of the Sringeri Matam, and made Sureshwaracharya as a supervisor of the head. Supervisor of the head of that madam, that Prithvi. Because, you know, Sureshwaracharya is always looked upon by other disciple as an exponent of Purva Mimamsakar. Though he became sannyasi, though he became Sureshwaracharya, previously, he was a Mandana Mishra, isn't it? So, he was an exponent in Purva Mimamsakar. So, they always think that, you know, there should be something in his mind about Purva Mima, karma theory. And he is not an Advaitic person. So many people, so even Adi Shankara, he was sad, you know, knowing about all this thing. Because Sureshwaracharya, he wanted to write the explanation for the Bhashyam of Brahma Sutra. But you know, other disciples, they thought that, you know, he was one of the great exponent of Purva Mimamsa. So that is karma theory. So he may include this karma there in the Bhashyam. Okay, in explaining the Bhashyam. So, you know, they were jealous. And Acharya himself told that there is no need for. So that's why Acharya said, you know, because they were jealous and all the disciples were thinking about it, he felt even sad. Acharya felt even sad and he, you know, told that, you know, nobody, there is no need for explaining the Bhashyam of Brahma Sutram. But still, Padmapada did. Padmapada, you know, he did the explanation of, explanation for the Bhashyam of Brahma Sutram of Acharyas. But one day what happened is Padmapada, he was explaining. He has written all the explanations for the Bhashyam. Bhashyam was written by Adi Shankara. See, Brahma Sutram was written by Veda Vyasa. And for that Brahma Sutram, Bhashyam was given by Adi Shankaracharya. And for that Bhashyam, explanation was given by Padmapada. But he was reading, he was, you know, he has explained all the things, and he wanted to get acknowledgement from Adi Shankara. So he started reading to Adi Shankaracharya his explanations in order to get the acknowledgement. But, you know, Adi Shankara just smiled and kept quiet. See, you can't take it, whether it is right or wrong. See, he only smiled, you know. So Padmapada, he felt, you know, what is this, whether it is right or wrong, we don't know. So that's why, you know, he stopped that explanation. He said to Adi Shankaracharya that, you know, I want to go to some holy places to have darshan of, you know, Lords. Adi Shankara told that you can stay, you can go for holy places, but you can stay for only smaller time, short period of time. Don't stay for long time. So thus, you know, Padmapada, he started, you know, visiting holy places, and he want to go to Rameshwaram. He want to go to Rameshwaram there. So he was traveling to Rameshwaram, and on the way, what happened is, on the way, he stopped at Thiruvanikkaval. Thiruvanikkaval, there's one place called Thiruvanikkaval. He stopped there. That's also a holy place only. There, Mama was there. That is, now he is sannyasi. That is, now Sanandanar became Padmapada, no? Then he was Sanandanar. That is, Purva Ashram. When he was in Purva Ashram, means Sanandanar. When he was in, as a Sanandanar, his mama was there. His uncle was there in Thiruvanikkaval. Stays in Thiruvanikkaval. So what he did his, he visited that Thiruvanikkaval. He kept all the palm leaves. He has written all the explanations, isn't it, for the Bhashyam. And he kept all the palm leaves where the explanation was written. He kept there. He said to his mama that it is all there. I will go to Rameshwaram. I will come back and I will pick up all those things and I will go to see Acharya. But what happened is, when he went, he kept there in his house, in the uncle's house, and then he went to Rameshwaram. But his uncle, that is Padmapada's uncle, he is a Purva Mimamsaka. He is very, very, you know, strong in karma theory. So he started reading all the works of Padmapada. He was, you know, he was not, he took the palm leaf, read all the explanations. He doesn't like the way he has written. Like, he has explained it in the Advaitic way, isn't it? Padmapada has explained everything in the Advaitic way, but he doesn't like that. His mama doesn't like that. And so what he did is, he set fire to those palm leaves where Padmapada, you know, has explained all the Bhashyam and all. So he doesn't want that Padmapada to know his evil deed also. So what happened, he set fire, you know, he set fire to his own house to show that everything was burnt. So after returning from Rameshwaram, Padmapada came to know about this, you know, fire accident and all. So he felt so sad, you know, he reached Acharya, that is Adi Shankaracharya. After visiting, you know, Rameshwaram and all, he reached Adi Shankaracharya and he told, you know, very sadly, he narrated all the story. See, I have explained all the theory, all the things, the Bhashyams and all. I kept in my mama's house, but he set fire. You know, everything was burnt and my work has all gone. He was very sad. But Adi Shankara told, you know, don't have to worry. You don't worry about that. You know, whatever you have on that day before, you know, you have said to me, that is the first part of explanation, all the first part of explanation, he has described Acharya, isn't it? Before going to that Rameshwaram, he has explained. Isn't it? He was telling to Acharya, but previously, isn't it? So he read to Acharya before going to Rameshwaram, isn't it? So Acharya said, I remembered everything. You know, everything I remembered. Whatever you have said, I remembered. You can write it. Now I will dictate. Okay? Now you write it. So, see, that kind of memory power, you know, that kind of eka chanda grahi. That means whatever you say once, you know, they can grasp things because of the brahmacharyam. Brahmacharyam they kept for 12 years. If one has kept brahmacharyam for 12 years, then you can grasp things so easily. You know, you will remember that how, that's how the memory power will be there. So Acharya remembered everything. So, and he dictated this knowledge. So this is the first, there is only the first five stanzas. Padmapadal, you know, first five stanzas of this Padmapadal, you know, is called Panchapadika of Brahma Sutram. Only little part is available now. You know, everything is blunt and, you know, only little part is available. But, you know, they have given, you know, all our acharyas, you know, they have given their best knowledge. They have given all the knowledge to us to grasp. And it is now our duty to grasp this, at least the slogans, which, you know, Adi Shankaracharya, he has given all the slogans of different gods, you know, all the slogans he has given. And it's now our duty to learn all the slogans, at least to learn, at least to chant daily all the slogans. You know, this is how we can show respect to our acharyas, by learning. And, you know, at least, you know, you can always, you children, you can always keep like that. You know, Monday, I can chant this Lingashtakam. Tuesday, I can chant this Durga, something. You know, Wednesday, I can chant Saraswati slogan. Thursday, I can chant Guru slogan. Friday, I can chant some Ambal slogan. Saturday, I can chant some Vishnu slogan. Sunday, I can chant Aditya Hridayam. Like that way, you can divide. You can all learn all the slogans. You know, all the slogans are all given by our acharyas. You know, our Purva acharyas. They are given for us. For the wellness, you know. We have to take care of ourselves. Our mother is there. Parents are there. And acharya guru is also there to look after us. But we have to, you know, chant all those things to, in order to get the benefit for us. Okay. So we'll close the session today and we'll meet next time. That is next week with all the other beautiful stories of Acharya. So start learning about Adi Shankara's slogans now. So we'll conclude this one by Purnamidam. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purna Purnamudachyate. Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Thank you all. Thank you. We'll see next week. Okay.